But, yeah. One thing I do want to talk about, and I'm sorry this is going everywhere, I didn't take my ADD medicine today. I just... One thing I want to talk about...
In a past life of mine,
I was high as shit. I'm not gonna lie. So I'm sitting there, and it's late. It's tomorrow. You know how they had a movie? It's like the angel and the devil on your shoulders, right? So in my head, it's like 12:20 a.m. The angel on my shoulder is that voice of reason, that responsibility in your life. So it's my mom, right? She immediately said, "We got food in the house." Right? The marijuana on my other shoulder said, "Fuck that, okay? Treat yourself." So because I gave myself, I called the pizza place, I ordered a medium pepperoni pizza with 10 lemon pepper wings, like a bad bitch, right? I got dressed and I went to go get the food. Now, I went and got the food, but everything was fine. I was on my way back. Now, this at this time, I'm living in Park Heights. So I gotta walk through a dark alley to get to my house. My mom ain't raised no bitch. So I'm like, all right, let's go. Then out of nowhere, I just hear out of the shadows, "Can I get a slice?" I immediately back the fuck up. But here's the thing that fucked me up. This crack lady came out of this, like the darkness, like an evil mastermind. And I don't know anybody who ever been on drugs, but what does this do for your high? Because she came out of darkness, she was like, she was pointing at the box, right? So at first I'm like, should this be my good deed for the day? Should I, you know, pay it forward? Then I saw her dirty crackly fingers and I was like, fuck that. The marijuana took over again. Here's the part about a crackhead that's so near and dear to my heart. A crackhead lie is so good you halfway believe it. Right? So when she said that and she saw I made a decision before I said anything, she immediately went into her story. She said, "You know what? Fuck you, motherfucker. You could have been on TV, but you chose otherwise." Here's the part that fucked me up. She put the crackhead braces to her face and said, "Turn the fucking cameras off." And disappeared for the night. I did. Now let me ask you real quick, sir. You ever seen a movie and it's like, I feel like I've seen a version of this before, right? I have an untapped market. You might want to fuck with me after this, right? Netflix is definitely giving me at least $3 million for this one. Right? It's about a time traveling crackhead. Now, stay with me. At the very beginning of this movie, you have a crack dealer turned priest. Now, you know this because he has on the priest collar, but he got the pooch icy mask on top of his head. Right? So he has the crack rocks, he dips it into the holy water. Tight street. Then after that, the camera cuts to the main protagonist. You have a crackhead. Now he comes across this priest, and the priest is like, "God has changed my life. I don't need this." Right? He hands it off. Anybody in here familiar with the Marvel Cinematic Universe speaks in this? So for the people who didn't clap, look around and see who's not getting fucked tonight. I just want to throw that out. But you know, so when he gets the crack rocks, right? And he's thinking, you know, this is something, it must be free testers on the street. I just ain't get the memo. So he goes to smoke, and when he starts to smoke the crack rock, it starts to glow different colors, right? He time travels, but he can't pick where he goes in time. The only thing that's constant is he goes to times in his life where he made the obvious decision to become a crackhead, right? I don't have the ending, but I got the hardest title for it. Jesus is my rock. Think about that. Think about that. On the point that I have a lot of time to think. So I have a few $1 million ideas. If you want to fuck with me, get at me after the show. All right, you can invest and be an angel investor. I'm going through my first round. It's great. But the first idea is about a Baltimore translation of the Bible. Right? Stay with me. This just got interesting. I'm going to give you a story. So you got five of Jesus' disciples. You got Andrew of Greenmount. You got John of Bel Air Road. You got James of Murphy Holmes. Peter of Penlucy and Judas of Southeast DC. Right? So they're going along and they name Lake Montebello, but they're coming from Lake Rowland. So it's a little bit of a hike, right? But who they come across but Jesus of Park Heights. Now, Jesus of Park Heights is very different than you know Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus of Nazareth will take one loaf of bread and stretch that for the whole village. Jesus of Park Heights will take one brick and beat the streets. Like, so they come across Jesus of Park Heights and they fuck with him. He got a little motion and he got the perks for the low. So they come across him and he says, "You know what? I got free tests for everybody, right? But one of y'all has to believe in the power of the pinks. Step out onto the water and come and get them." Everybody stopped. Dead silence. That's when Peter Pan-Lucy stands up and says it made his tongue. I'll go over there. I ain't no whore. Right? So that's why everybody starts cheering him on. Yeah, Stoops, you got this, dummy. Then Judas of Southeast DC stands up and says, kill Jah like Mo. Peter Pan-Lucy starts to drown. This is the hardest part of the story. This is where you're going to want to invest. You ready? Jesus of Parkites goes over, reaches into the water, and says, think of an all-white tenant out on the coop. And the niggas start to rise from the water. In fact, another thing is, been readjusting is my girlfriend. Anybody who don't know, I've been in a relationship for going on 5 years now. Don't laugh, but she be fucking me up. You know how many times I've been around family, she be looking at me saying, another motherfucking word. And her family knows too. Because when some shit go down, and we getting into it, they be looking at me like, nigga, shut the fuck up. That's what we need to do. 9 months not really having that type of interaction, you have to readjust, reacclimate yourself, right? So I'm like, I'm not ready to come out the gate strong on some shit. So I decided the first time, like, it was just silent, right? But here's the thing, she turned around, she was like, talk, nigga. I ain't know what to do. I decided to take it to the other end of the spectrum. I turned it to the nigga from the casting couch. I was like, you do this to pay the bills, don't you, girl? We'd be sitting at home, she'd look at me and ask a dumbass question like, what would our wedding be like? What the fuck are you talking about? Really, what the fuck are you talking about? You know how you go through a situation, any young man, any man here under 30 can say they've been through a situation, they had a woman come to you and be like, babe, would you love me if I was a fly? So when she asked that, I decided, it's something in me just snapped, right? Men, I took our power back. I put the situation on her. I said, why? So you can plan a bachelorette party, and then you get a pizza guy, but he's not a real pizza guy. He's a stripper, and when he comes in, he opens a box, and his dick falls out. And he be sitting there like, who wants some deep dish sausage? Before I get on out of here, I would just like to say that on October 12, 1999, an Amazon box set of 80 was born. Right? 23 years later, he's on Baltimore Comedy Festival. Yeah. So you can never tell me that if you don't want some shit bad enough, you can't achieve that. Every sad, crazy story, it ends with a silver lining. It always has a moral to it. And the moral to this story is that according to my mom, as you can see, I've been shitting on niggas my whole life.